another prepare us for the day of the Lord when Jesus Christ returns. May his grace and love be always with you.
And also with you.
For those of us following on Facebook Live, it is a lovely rainy day here in Orlando, very gloomy and all. And we're celebrating the second Sunday of Advent. And we are going to light two of the candles on our Advent. Tremendous amounts of money are spent to build better roads, except here in Orlando with I-4, to have better communications. But there still remains a lot of obstacles among people, even nations, to communicate with one another. In the same way, there are still many obstacles to the coming of our Savior in our world. People put up roadblocks, and we have to remove them. So that is mercy and freedom, is justice and love may reach all people. If only all could encounter the Savior and experience God's salvation through him and in him and work in us too. Let's ask Jesus in this Eucharist that we may be the road to him and that we may bring people nearer to him every time we meet them, as we say at the end of Mass every week out there. We are the people of the road, pilgrims on the way, and we sometimes stumble and fall. We now ask the Lord to forgive us. Lord Jesus, you brought us freedom and justice and opened wide for us the way to our eternal parents and to people. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Jesus Christ, you showed to us the path to the peace and forgiveness of Christ. Christ, have mercy. Lord Jesus, you lead us on the road of love and generosity, and you want to bring your salvation to all. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Have mercy on us, Lord, and fill us with the joy of your pardon. Wipe away the tears of sorrow, and make us sing of the gladness of everlasting life. Let us pray. God of many titles and names, we know today how to pierce mountains and level hills to build highways, but we have not lost the way to each other's heart and to you. Let your Son come among us to make us inventive and daring enough to build roads of justice and love that make us encounter one another and you, our living God. We ask this in the name of him whom we expect and who is waiting for us, Jesus, our brother.
First reading is a reading from the book of the prophet
Baruch.
Jerusalem, take off your robe of misery and mercy. You will wear God's glorious splendor forever. Wrapped in the cloak of God's justice, you will wear on your head the crown that displays the glory of the eternal name. For God will show all the earth your splendor. Your eternal name will be peace through justice and honor through devotedness. Up, Jerusalem, stand upon the heights. Look to the east and see your children gathered from the east and the west at the holy word of the Holy One. rejoicing that God remembers them. Led away on foot by their enemies, they left you. But God will bring them back to you, borne aloft in glory as on royal thrones. For God has commanded that every lofty mountain be made low, and that the age-old depths and gorges fill to the level ground, that Israel may advance secure in the glory of God. The forests and every fragrant kind of tree will give shade to Israel at God's command. For God is leading Israel in joy by the light of divine glory, escorted by mercy and justice. This is the word of God.
And Trachodonus and Licinius, Tetrarch of Abilene. In those days, during the high priesthood of Annas and Caiaphas, the word of God came to John, begot of Zechariah, in the desert. John went through the entire region of the Jordan, proclaiming a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins, as is written in the words of Isaiah the prophet, a herald's voice in the desert crying, make ready the way of our God, clear a straight path. Every valley shall be filled, and every mountain and hill will be leveled. The twisted paths will be made straight, and the rough roads smooth. And all humankind will see the salvation of God, the good news of our salvation.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
We've had an interesting week with the funeral of President Bush, and I found it interesting, I was saying to Sandy, that even at the funeral that he had at the Washington Cathedral, the pastor of his church from Houston who gave the homily used my exact words in the beginning. That life has changed, not ended, like you've heard me say. Oh, we're obviously on the same road, same union, we think the life, which is good. As human beings, we seem to be created for teamwork. It's not always easy. Those of us that work out there, we know it's not always easy. But we know that there's something deeply satisfying about working together. You know? This is where I could break into song with the Seven Dwarfs. You know, hi-ho, hi-ho, it's off to work we go. You know, and it's about sharing values, sharing ideas. It seems that God is the same way. Remember that God is a Trinity. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And God doesn't act alone. He invites others to be part of his plan. That's where we come in. He invites each one of us to be part of that plan and to bring the joy of Christianity to others. That's why I say we're the ambassadors. We didn't have to be approved by Congress. We are already the ambassadors, given by our baptism. St. Paul brings this out in the second reading today that Carmen read. He says to the people of Philippi, I pray always with joy in my prayer for all of you because of your partnership for the gospel from the first day until now. The gospel means the good news of Christ. What is the gospel? The gospel, as I've said before, is the Monarch Notes or the Cliff Notes, whatever you used to use in high school to do those book reports instead of really reading the book, and of giving us the way to live our life here on earth. That's very, very simple. To quote the old Geico commercial, even a caveman could do it. You know, when you really look at it. And what is the good news? It's the message that in Jesus, God has become part of our personal story. And St. Paul is saying to each of us that we have a role in sharing in the message. The word that St. Paul uses in Greek is koinonia, big fancy Greek word, koinonia, which means communion. That's what it means, koinonia. It's communion. So it's actually a deeper partnership than, say, you might have with those that you work with, you know, your comrades at work. Because God has chosen to meet us. It's kind of weird to think that God needs something. You know, we always think of God as all-powerful, all-knowing, all But God needs all of us to work with God in helping the earth. You know, we each have a role, shall we say, in this play called life. Some of us are stars. Some of us are just the back. Some of us are just the chorus. But we all have a role to do. In the gospel today, we have John the Baptist. John the Baptist is an interesting dude. He's very interesting. Because he's Jesus' cousin. Boy, is that rain really important. Mm-hmm. Okay, Baptist, water, rain. We would probably institutionalize him today if he was living in our society, because the description of John the Baptist is of a freak. He's a weirdo. He wears camel skin, you know, for his clothing. He likes to eat honey and locusts, which for us today we would probably equate it with cockroaches, you know. He's going around saying, "Repent, repent, repent." You probably see someone like him at, you know, in Boston Common or in Central Park, you know, or whatever. You know, those people that you see, you know, the world's coming to an end and all this stuff, you know. By our standards today, he was a freak. He should be institutionalized. But at that day and time, he was preaching the good news, saying there's somebody better than I that's coming. That's why we call him the herald. He was like the Ed. I'm dating myself here, folks. For those of you that are watching that are younger, you won't have a clue what I'm saying. He was the Ed McMahon to Johnny Carson. Okay? That's the way you got to look at John the Baptist. He was the Ed McMahon. And Jesus was Johnny Carson. Oh, but think of it. You know, that's what he was. He was the herald. Just like all these people have their, on late night talk show, their person that introduces them and, you know, that gets them ready. The audience going and all of that. That's what John the Baptist was. You know, and he was saying, repent. This world is screwed up. And God's Son is coming. What type of setting are we giving God's Son? A screwed up world or what? You know, he was trying to make things nicer. And from tradition, evidently he was very verbose. He wasn't quiet. You know, he was very animated and all that's up there. You know, so it was interesting, you know, the character that he plays. You know, in Godspell, the play starts with a person, it's supposed to be John the Baptist, who is blowing a shofar. Now, a shofar is the trumpet. It's made out of a ram's horn, and saying, prepare ye the way of the Lord, you know? And so that's what we focus in on the second Sunday of Advent, is that we are now the John the Baptists. I don't think any of you eat locusts, but
not really.
And honey. Wild honey. Are you ready, locusts? Chocolate, with chocolate color. You know, and what are we doing to herald the second coming of Christ? The first, you know, the baby was already born. You know, it's cute to remember, you know, the mangers and all that stuff, but he's already come. He's coming again. You know, almost like Douglas MacArthur. I shall return. You know, that's basically Christ is coming again. When? We don't know. How? We don't know. but it was promised and foretold that it's going to come again. So what are we doing? You know, and how do we become the ambassadors? Basically, it's what is Jesus to you? And has Jesus become part of your life? You know, one thing that a certain person that you know who I'm talking about, who I've been dealing with since May, I've said to the person, you and I are different because Jesus has been part of my life. You know, doesn't, I'm not a puppet, but that's why I have faith. I don't give up. You know, and last night we were doing our usual, why me, why am I suffering like this, etc., etc. And I had to, you know how I told you I had a kick when someone was down? So I kind of did a naughty thing, folks. I kind of used a Protestant line. And I said, and you're talking about your suffering? And you're saying to God, why are you suffering? Didn't you see what he did to his own son? I said, beaten to a pulp, and nails through him, and a sword through his side, and all that. And you're worrying about this? I said, that's what your real Bible thumpers and all of it said. Actually, I was covering it up, because he would have rejected it. You know, and that's true. You've got to make Christ yourself, part of you. You know, I'm not into this, where you got to accept him as your personal Lord and Savior and all this sort of stuff. He's your dude. He's your BFF. You know, he's the guy you're going to bring here to St. Matthew's when the bar is open and you're going to have a cocktail with. You know, you're going to take him with you when you go Christmas shopping. Yeah. You know, that's what you got to make Jesus. And once he is that for you, then you're ready to go out and share that with everybody. And I don't mean Bob Brady beating, you know, proselytizing, you know, again, I go back to Bush's funeral because the president gave that pastor of the church in Houston a gift one day, and it was a simple plaque. And he brought the plaque and he showed the plaque. And then when he read the plaque, I'm like, The plaque said, basically, spread the gospel. Use words if you have to. And all of you should know where that came from St. Francis of Assisi. So you can see, you know.
That funeral, I mean, so many things came that I could relate to from here.
Oh, yeah.
Again, the changing of, it's not the end of life, it's
right.
A different kind of life.
Right.
I mean,
you know, I'm glad to see more when I hear stuff like that. I'm glad that others are adopting our philosophy, so to speak, you know, which is cool. Maybe we are bringing it out there a little more. We don't even know it, and it's and it's happening, you know, which is cool. You know, think about how has Jesus changed your life? Obviously, you're here because you have faith and trust. God in the Trinity, however you want to explain it to yourself. You know that the Eucharist is important because that's your spiritual food that you need to get through another week of crap that this world dishes out. You know? So it's so important to all of us that's here. Let me do my story. Because it kind of a weird thing, and I'll explain. Have you ever heard of John Henry Newman? John Henry Newman was a cardinal. A cardinal Newman. Okay? And those of you who have gone to college, okay, Catholic or, you know, public or private, whatever, every single college in the United States has, and they call it by different names, the Newman Center or stuff like that. That's for the Catholics to go to that college. Yeah, every Catholic school, you know, colleges have it, but also public colleges have it. and it's like a group that's part of the college, you know, and all of that. Well, Cardinal Newman, this past week, as I was getting this ready, I get on something that's like, you know, a news app, but it tells me all the Catholic news, you know, just Catholic news. And as I was getting this ready, I'm looking at my app, and I'm like, oh boy, because Cardinal Newman, he's a blessing, okay? And a second miracle was attributed to him. This past week. It was approved by the Vatican. You know, and I have explained to you in the past how they go through, you know, miracles and the whole process. And so I thought that was funny. Here I am going to talk about him in my sermon, and he is the miracle. Already, he needs one more, and he'll be declared a saint. So we're not that far. But in 1848, he wrote this. Lord, you have created me to do some definitive service. You have committed some work to me that you have not committed to another person. I have my mission. I am a link and a chain, a bond of connection between persons. I shall do good. I shall do your work. I shall be an angel of peace, a preacher of truth. My own place. While not intending it, if I but do your commandments and serve you in my calling, let me read to you the whole prayer. I just gave you an excerpt. God has created me to do him some definite service. He has committed some work to me which he has not committed to another. I have my mission. I may never know it in this life, but I shall be told it in the next. I am a link in the chain, a bond of connection between persons. He has not created me for naught. I shall do good. I shall do his work. I shall be an angel of peace, a preacher of truth in my own place, while not intending it, if I do but keep his commandments. Therefore, I will trust him. Whatever I am, I can never be thrown away. If I am in sickness, my sickness will serve him. In perplexity, my perplexity may serve him. If I am in sorrow, my sorrow may serve him. He does nothing in vain. He knows what he is about. He may take away my friends. He may throw me among strangers. He may make me feel desolate, make my spirit sink, hide my future from me. Still, he knows what he is about. That's what he wrote. Just like him, just like John the Baptist, each of us has a mission to share the good news. That we are known and loved by God. Our lives are busy, let's face it. And it's hard to find time to reflect on our personal mission in life. We can forget that we are partners with God in sharing the good news and that God is with us. But imagine now, a football coach who never takes time to review the last Sunday's game. If he doesn't do that, he won't have a clear sense of his mission, where the players messed up and everything, or did great. His king isn't going to go far. Advent in the church gives us this time to ponder our mission. Basically, the church is asking, which is kind of a controversial contradiction because of the season we're in and what we tend to do during the season. Advent is actually a time for us to slow down. You know, and ask some questions. What is my mission? My mission, I know, is to drive all of you crazy. How am I a partner with God? What is my job? Here's some ideas. Take 10 minutes maybe to pray. You got the books now from St. Clair. Hopefully that's helping. This Advent. It's 4 weeks. Advent is 4 weeks. We're in the second week already. So after 4 weeks, look back on this and see if your life has changed by you stopping 10 minutes a day. And as I say kiddingly, the best time to pray is when you're in the porcelain box. Because nobody's there to bug you. You know, it's just you. Best time. You know, it's true. It's true, Ray. Very true. You know, we don't think of it like that. As John says, I make it real.
A little too real.
You know? Read a book. You know, a couple of suggestions are Matthew Kelly's Rediscovering Catholicism and Forming Intentional Disciples by Sherry Wendler. Those are a couple of them. You know, there are others. Take time and watch a Christmas movie. Just sit and watch and veg. And think about the lesson in the Christmas movie. You know, there's always some lesson in it. You never know. It doesn't always mean boy meets girl, boy falls in love, you know, and all of that. A lot of them have subtle meanings that are in them. They do preach subtly to all of us. You know? Do something but just center yourself during this Advent so that you and Jesus will have a better relationship and a closer relationship than what you already have. You know? And be open to those. Learn from each other. All of you have come into my life. You know, I've come into all your lives. You know, there's a reason for it. As it was stated, you might not know the reason now. You might find out the reason later.
Or maybe never.
Or maybe never. But do the best you can. You know, and once again, I close with RuPaul's statement. If you can't love yourself, how are you going to love others? That's it. Your turn.
Saying that person isn't worth it, or you're angry with them, or whatever. himself be crucified. And he said, well, I really didn't want to lose that whole thing. But anyway, I can get out of this. Yeah. I mean, he had to make that leap at some point.
But that's how these pieces is different, you know? I can't. There are limits to what I would be able to do for someone, whether I wanted, you know, thought it was the right thing to do or not. He's different. He's set aside.
We all have our limitations.
Yes, and I guess that's what I'm saying. I wouldn't even begin to compare myself or say, oh yeah, I would do that. No, I know I wouldn't be able to do that. All the way, all the time, to that extreme. You know,
we're supposed to.
We're supposed to do the best.
His whole purpose was to model.
We model different things, different people at different times in different ways, and it isn't always followed. Neither.
That's true.
Father Jim is raising his eyebrows, so I'm assuming I'm wrong. But I don't know that. I'm sure he doesn't like what I'm saying. I am just being honest. At the point, I would not say, go for it, crucify me.
It's your
for
turn.
All of you. I'll try, and I will try and do my best. But I don't know that I'm sure it wouldn't be to that extreme.
No, you're right. You actually said it.
Because it's his thing.
You're going to try. And that's all he asks of all of us, is to try. Knowing that we're going to screw up. You know?
Short
the first time.
Coming short fall.
You know, and basically, Sandy, what he's doing there is trying to show us is, you love everybody with unconditional love. If they're the best saint or they're the biggest SOB dog, you still love them. Because that's what I'm trying to show you. And Celia came up with a new bumper sticker. What would Daddy do? Instead of what would Jesus do? You know, and it's true, because he wanted to show us how to live, but knowing that we're not puppets, like you clearly say. You know, and the only thing we can do is our best, so that when you close your eyes in death, you can face whomever is there. Now, I don't know if they have schedules or who's at the, you know, whatever.
Who's at the door?
Who's at the door, you know, I don't know. And you can say, at least I gave it my best. With an open heart. That's all you can do. You know? Even the saints could only do what they do. You know? But they messed up.
That's why we're born.
Yes. 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 I wouldn't put Jesus separate, because he was like us in all things but sin. And then the garden.
That's a big one.
He turned chicken. He really did. But what's the line you forget? After he said, you know, you turn chicken, he said, but not as I want. Yeah, we dress it up, but I don't do that. It's a, all right, Dad, I don't want to go through this, but you want me to, so I'm going to do it. Because I have faith and trust in you. It's going to suck, but I believe, because he was even doubting. This is where we don't take it the next step. At that time, he was turning chicken, as I like to call it. He was even doubting his resurrection. We forget that part. He knew what was going to happen. He knew he was going to get crucified. He was going to get the shit beat out of him, the whole nine yards. And he also knew about the resurrection, because remember how he was destroyed the temple, but it's too late. You know, so at that point, he was even. And whatever you want, Dad. Now I have full faith. So in the garden, he showed us that we too were going to have crises of faith. Because he did too. And it's not a bad thing. St. Paul said, if they don't accept you, shake the dust from your feet and move on. But, you know, he didn't say, if they don't accept you, you know, treat them like crap, and then shake the dust from your feet, and, you know,
right.
And all of that. You know, so, you're not going to be, I don't know how to say it, you're not going to be loved by everybody.
And you're not going
and
to
you're
be
not
going
love everybody. But you treat them correctly as a child of God, you know, and you don't treat them like scum or whatever, or make fun of them, or make fun of their nationality, or where they're from, or whatever. Right? You know, and
I think that's where I found myself. I won't disrespect you. I will water my way. I won't disrespect you because for some, only God knows why reason, he put that person here.
Yeah.
And, or that thing, whatever it is.
And that person came into your life, maybe to teach you something that you don't know.
And so, you know, no disrespect, but I can't embrace necessarily. So to me, as long as I don't hurt or disrespect, treat others like you would like to be treated.
Exactly. And when you think of scripture, you know, and I know I'm probably sticking my neck out on this.
Mm-hmm. So what's the...
You know, yeah, so what else is there? Jesus never really disrespected anyone. Now you might say, okay, the money changers in the temple and all that, was that disrespect? No, because they were doing something seriously wrong. And he was, maybe, did he overreact?
Maybe.
Don't we overreact sometimes?
Yeah.
So again, he shows us, hey, I'm human. I might have overreacted a little bit. You know, overturning the tables, and if you go back to the actual scripture, he made a whip and he was beating crap on us. Some of them, we cleaned that up a bit, you know? And because I could see people, you know, down the road saying, well, that's fine to beat the shit out of someone because Christ did it in the Bible, you know, that sort of thing. You know, but that shows that he overreacted to it. Doesn't make it right. You know, but it shows again that he was human. He was like us in all things but sin. So he had to go through the gamut of emotions if he was going to be like us. And what we do, we have to take that and make that real. We have to take Christ off of the pedestals and with the big halos and everything. And that's why I say, you have to make him your best friend. The dude you're going to take to the bar to have a drink, you're going to take him out, you know, to the Firebirds to have a dinner with. And, you know, when you're in rough shape, that person is still going to be there for you. Oh, you remember the story I told you that happened with the gentleman that really wanted Christ in his life, and he was very sick. And, you know, just pretend, the chaplain said, pretend that he's sitting in the chair here in the hospital room, you know, and just talk to him like a friend. And then when the nurse came in, the gentleman had, you know, was like slumped over in the chair. He was in the bed, but his position was like in the chair as if he had his head on the person in the chair. That's how he died. So he did make Christ his BFF. You know? That's what I mean. That's what you're going to make Christ to you. The dude that's going to be there. Just like, think of your best friend from high school, if you're still with them or know them or, you know, whatever. You know, how do you treat them? That's the way you should be treating Christ. Not somebody to be afraid of. Somebody that's going to be there to help you, even through the darkest of crap, you know, that might happen. You're not gonna be abandoned. We might feel abandoned. But the dude is still there. You know? There's always help. There's always help. You got extra help now.
Oh, I got, yeah.
Hey, you got extra help now. You know? So use it.
Well, I can ask, oh, isn't it sad? Or aren't you feeling this? Of course. You know, it's my mom. How could I not be sad? But then, after everything she went through, and seeing her, knowing what she had been like, and seeing what she was now, I always wonder, why is she still having it? What is it that is keeping her from you? I don't know if she came to the
finalize what it was and said, okay, I can go now. I know she couldn't just take it anymore. And just let, I don't know. We'll never, maybe never know. Maybe one day I'll go back and say, oh, no wonder. She knew this was going to happen, so I can go now. And I said, am I sad? Of course. You know, she's my woman. I don't have her anymore. But she's in such a better place.
Yeah, you have all the different lives.
There, exactly. And she's back with Dad. Oh, God. God help her.
No, but I mean, I'm going to correct one thing that you said.
Uh-oh. It's just one thing.
It's one thing.
It's one big thing.
You don't have her anymore. Well, you don't have her
No,
anymore.
I don't have her physically.
You don't have the physical body
right,
anymore.
Right.
No? But she is.
Oh, now she's at a better level. At a better level, I have her now.
Yes.
Yes.
At a much better
level. No, that's what I meant, that I cannot go see her.
Right. And again, I go back to George Bush. You know, if you followed any of the funeral this week, you heard it said that when the son George knew that Dad was on his way out, and he called him and he spoke to him, that was his dad's last words were, "I love you," and then he passed. You know, think about it. No, not that I'm exalting George Herbert Walker Bush to Christ level, but isn't that an awesome last thing to say?
Yeah.
Same thing that basically Jesus said from the cross. You know, when he said, "Woman, there is your son," you know, he was telling the world, "I still love you, even though I'm going through all this crap. I still love you, and Father, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing." He's still forgetting. You know, he could have easily, you know, do a hocus pocus and put some sort of curse or, you know, whatever you want to call it. But no, he was showing forgiveness and love even till the very end.
And I can't believe he planned the whole funeral.
Yeah.
Right through the train ride home and the meal on the train for his family.
But that shows how much love. And I learned something too, not that I want to prolong. I don't want to prolong this, but driving in, I was listening to Cardinal Dolan from New York. And the time that Bush was president, he was working at the Apostolic Nuncio. And that's the residence of the Apostolic Nuncio, who was the Pope's representative in the United States. And a cute story that was told that he was telling, because he was a priest, he wasn't a cardinal.
Regular
priest from Milwaukee working and so and the Apostolic Nuncio and Vice President Bush at the time were very close. They used to even play tennis together because the Apostolic Nuncio residence is across the street from the Vice President's house, okay, in D.C. And so they became buddies. George calls the Apostolic Nuncio, who was Pio Laghi, and I knew Pio Laghi because I wrote to him when I opened up Ave Maria, and he was influential in getting me a papal blessing for the opening of the school. So that I hope that's still hung up at the school from John Paul II. But he calls the Apostolic Nuncio and he says, Pio, you know, during first meeting, my son is marrying a Catholic, and he's going to convert to Catholicism. I heard you guys have a new baptism on. And if he, if he's going to marry a Catholic, I better know what's going on. Even though he was a very faithful Episcopalian, very high, which is, you know, Catholic low cop, you know, is basically Episcopalian. And so Pio sends him over to the Catechism of the Catholic Church, and then they get a call that he was all done with it. And so, you know, he wanted to give it back. And so here comes Dolan, goes and gets it. And when he gets it, it's all marked up.
No.
There's little, there's tabs in it, you know, sticky things, and and it's like it read S.P.O. about this, you know. Yeah. So he actually read the Catechism of the Catholic Church, and he had questions on it, and then Dolan gives it to P.O., and P.O.'s like, calls him back and says, George, this is for you to keep. You know, that type of thing. So you can see the man was very into the faith, you know, and into, even though his son was going to leave Episcopalianism and become
a Catholic.
No, but some of the teachings are a little bit different. And, you know, that was cool. And then another quick story that was told was that they really wanted a naval officer for Christmas. And I don't know if you know any traditions, Christmas Eve is fish. Seven fishes and all of that stuff. And so the person who was giving it to them for Maine, the Maine officer, of course, said, my God, if I try to send it to the White House, it's going to go through security, and those poor lobsters, you know, need a passport and get everything to get through. So they sent it to the Apostolic Nuncio. And then Dolan's job was to bring it to the White House. And they knew all about this. The white, you know, the Bushes knew.
It was set up that way.
It was set up that way. So here Dolan calls the number that was given to him. You know, once you get the lobster, call this number, you know. And so he's thinking it's, you know, Secret Service or whatever. It was Barbara Bush's cell phone. And here she answers, and, you know, talking to Dolan, and yeah, no problem. Just bring her. We got it all set. Come on right over to, you know, he's president now, over to the White House. And so he gets to the gate thinking, you know, he's just going to drop it off. And the guard says to him, no, they want you up for a cup of coffee, so I go right in and right in. And again, it shows you how family has been run out. And again, someone like today's gospel, trying to be like a John the Baptist in his own way, being a herald. And every time it was told to us from Dolan on the radio this morning, every time there was a cardinal visiting or a summer for the Eastern Rite Church or anything where there's trouble in the church, any part of the world, and they were coming to the United States, Bush wanted to meet with them because he wanted to know how he could help. So again, regardless of faith or whatever, he was being an ambassador for Christ. He was being a John the Baptist in the way he could.
And they said that Bush was very laid back, very polite.
And that's important to use, you know, as, and again, all of this came out after his death, but I hope the country uses it as, oh, a role model.
Ambassador and reaching out and everything. I watched, it was the week that I was in Puerto Rico when my mom passed, and I was watching, and somebody was like, why, how can you be watching a funeral when your mom has just died, and it's too much, and, you know? And I thought, bringing it to what you're saying, he was propping me up, I guess, by him having died and all the religious things that were taking place. Mm-hmm. And it was sort of like helping me in an indirect way. His passing came to be like,
by listening and hearing, and it, you know, I could relate to so much of it.
Yeah.
And it was like, no, I don't, it's not morbid or to me to be watching this, it's helping me through it.
Yeah. And possibly, and I'm not.
So he was still doing his thing.
You know, he was still teaching after death, but also, and I just lost my train of thought, what you were saying. Oh, those who say to you, isn't this morbid, isn't this da-da-da, they're actually saying to you, Carmen, I don't have a grip on this death thing.
Yes.
And you do. Why? How? Your mother's gone. How come you're not sobbing or being like my mother's side of the family, who used to throw themselves on top of the casket at the cemetery and smelling salts and all of that, until my father one day didn't hold back one of my aunts and she realized she was going in the way.
I wasn't there.
That's a true story. He used to call it the Freitas Association, my mother's side of the family.
Drama family.
Yeah, drama queens. I think that's right. From my mother's side.
I explained it.
But, you know, you have a grasp on. You know that line. Life has changed, not ended. So you know. Yeah, I don't physically have that body anymore. The kiss, the hug, to argue with, whatever. But I know that she's still here because she's a child of God, and that soul is going to live on forever.
She's watching it with you.
That's the same thing. Quickly, and let me end.
I just feel my toes being pulled one night if I'm doing something that's not.
And I this past Thursday was January. It's from John the Baptist. He didn't eat that one. It was the feast of Saint Nicholas on December 6th, and that's what I use with kids when they're told there is no Santa Claus. Yes, there is a Santa Claus. Santa Claus is modeled after Saint Nicholas. And over the course of the ages, yes, we've developed lore that wasn't true and all the stuff in different countries. You know, Santa Claus, you know, when you do it in Latin, and it comes out Santa Claus eventually. And so I tell them, don't let anybody tell you there isn't a Santa Claus because it's after St. Nicholas. And if we as Catholics or Christians believe in the soul lives on, then St. Nicholas is living on. So there is a Santa Claus. There really is, Virginia. You know, there is a Santa Claus. And don't let others dispel you. Again, it might not be the fat guy in the red suit. It might not be the guy that looks like a fisherman. That's how Santa Claus is portrayed in Portugal. And my little Santa Claus statue. Portuguese Santa Claus. Or, you know, in the big red coat with the hood on it, Father Christmas is in England, and so forth. You know, but there was and there is still a Santa Claus. So don't let anybody tell you differently. And yes, you're kicking it up to a different level, but that's what this time of year is all about. Time for us to slow down and really take a look at our faith. And are we, this is probably the Independent Catholic's best time of the year. Because it tells us to slow down, take a real look at your faith, and everything that's man-made, chuck it away. Come back to the basics. Come back home to the basics. And that's what Bush kind of forced the country to. Again, and he's probably, and I'm not going to get into the politics part, but if you read between the lines,
oh boy, all the time,
everything that was said was like, dudes, you better go back to this model because what you're doing is wrong. Let's see if they listen. And your mother's saying to you, Carmen, you're still here. You still got to be that model for Christ, just as I was, even in that bed. I was still doing his work through you, through the person taking care of me, through the minister that would show up and I would open my eyes for, through your brother. And I'm trying to give you, think of it as, and I know my crazy analogy, think of you as a gas thing on a car. She was filling you up. Now you're full. Can't put any more gas in you. Now, go do it. I'm done. You go do it. Okay. I'm going to put here. Big Richard. Big Richard. That might be Big Richard telling me, you know.
Shut up!
Billy.
One question.
Sure.
Yes, she was born in heaven. She was raised in heaven. For 48 years. Okay. When we got together, Catholic was in my life. Religion was in my life.
Right.
I still remember the years. When I saw the ad in the paper, and it hit me pretty hard, and they talked about St. Dorothy at the Union Church. And I told them, you can never gather to get one, two, or one, four, and then it all kind of feel just how people were going to go in this way. I don't have a camera. It's okay. But I just want to know, she has a world of friends. She's a mentor, a great friend, a great sister. I don't care to die every night. She will not live me for 20 years. I'm believing that she has a gift that I gave her, and she will run us stronger than I. Now, is it wrong to wish for your life to be shorter so much as someone else has been upon you?
No, not at all, because you're wishing good, and you're not wishing ill on yourself. Sometimes you get to the point where you just had enough, and you're asking God, you know, maybe to take me, because I just can't take it. And that's what Father Mark did. Father Mark prayed for the Blessed Mother, saying, please take me. And obviously one night she said, all right, Mark, come on. Because you've had enough of crap here. So come with me, you're not going to get any more crap. But that was told to me after his death. That he actually did pray to me and he could. And so no, there's nothing to matter. But in doing so, you have to be open to God listening to your prayers, but God answering it
in God's time.
And it might not be that God is going to take you. The answer might be, no, Billy, you're staying here, but, like you said today, I got a job for you to do. You know, and that's going to be your job. And then when you're done with the job, then it's like, okay, come on. You finish the job, you know, no problem. So it's okay to do that, but don't go with the mindset that, okay, I'm praying for this, this is going to happen. It's going to 100% going to happen. because sometimes, you know, and we're terrible at this. We love to pray. Don't get me wrong. All of us love to pray. But sometimes we don't listen for the answer because we're impatient people. Or we want it done now. We want the answer now. You know, and like you've heard me say kiddingly, heaven has a terrible IT department. You're not going to get an email. You're not going to get a Facebook posting that's going to tell you what's going to happen. You know, so it's fine. It's perfectly fine. I'm not doing anything wrong. You know, I pray every day for somebody's death to happen because I don't want to see suffering anymore. I had to wrestle with myself on that. Am I doing something wrong praying for someone's death? You know, and I came to the realization that if you care for that person and you see the suffering, you're asking out of love and the suffering.
As long as you don't do it, it's...
Well, yeah.
No, it's up to God to please take over.
Yeah.
And do.
And you people are giving a red feet.
Well, you're a family. Where are your dysfunctional family? But we're your family!
Bill, that was something I wanted to say. When you said that you don't have your family anymore, your family still isn't here, but try to remember that we are your family now.
Yes.
We are your family.
That's what my brothers keep telling me.
We're your brothers.
Yeah.
We're your brothers. So you've got this family, you've got two families.
Yeah, you've got a lot. And we're all put into your life for a reason. Who knows why? So we've all been put in.
But what God is saying is, as long as you are here, here's the prayer. But He's also saying your being here is a gift for her because she is every day having the opportunity to love you and accept you and just want what's good for you too.
You know, good.
Just remember it's your marriage. Part of the marriage wasn't, and now, Leslie, here is Billy's instruction. And Billy, here's Leslie's instruction. She didn't come with, neither of you came with a man. So.
And it's for better or for worse.
Hey?
No.
Or it may be like me, you may read the instructions, and you're just as bothered as you were before. I remember my ex-husband saying, didn't you read the car manual?
Careful how they say that. You're a gift.
Yeah, we turn.
All right, let's continue on. Oh, you're welcome. Let's continue on by Professor Matthew.
Thank you.
And again, folks on Facebook Live, this is what makes our parish a little different than your run of the mill. I promise to see what is good for my sisters and brothers everywhere, rejecting injustice and inequality, and living with the freedom and responsibility of a child of God. I promise to work for the realization of God's vision of harmony and right relations among all peoples, rejecting the idols of money and property. I promise to seek peace and live in peace in one human family, rejecting prejudice in every form and all barriers to unity. I promise to cherish the universe and this precious planet, working creatively to renew, safeguard, and elevate. accept the salvation which Jesus offers to all. And our response will be, come Lord, wait no longer. For the Bishop of Rome, Francis, bishops, priests, deacons, and lay leaders, that they may strengthen us in our faith and help us to hasten the Lord's coming, we pray, come Lord, wait no longer. For all the faithful spread over the whole world, that they may be light for our times, to keep the faith and hope alive and active, and to work for more justice and honesty, let us pray.
Come Lord, wait no longer.
For all those who don't believe in God, that they too may place all their potentials in the service of people and the whole human community, let us pray. For those who are afraid of the future, that they may put aside their fears and distress and learn to hope in God and trust in His promises, let us pray.
Wait no longer.
For all of us gathered here, that our eyes may be open and our hearts built.
I can't say the word.
Vigilant, thank you. To recognize and receive Christ our Lord when He comes to encounter us, let us pray.
Lord, wait no longer.
Let us pray for the sick of our parish, for Carol Cole, for Joel Passmore, and for Marion, who was hospitalized for observation. They don't have a lot of tests, and we don't have the results back from the tests, but hopefully things will be going okay in her life right now, medical life right now, and that is just a little bump in the road. So we pray.
Come, Lord.
What other intentions do you have?
For my mom, who did say to God, come Lord, wait no longer.
Come Lord,
wait no longer. Continue prayers for Christian.
Come Lord,
wait no longer.
Christmas families that we're helping, that the Lord will touch them in a very special way and know that they are loved by us and our family here at St. Dorothy's, we pray.
Lord, wait no longer.
And for all the intentions you hold deep in the silence of your hearts, and for all those that are listed on our parish's website, we pray.
Lord, wait no longer.
Lord Jesus Christ, give us the will and the courage to remove the obstacles that separate us from each other and to level the road for your coming. Stay with us now and forever.
Amen.
Our offertory hymn is number 48 in the Missalette, page 199.
Every valley shall be exalted, and every hill made high.
God, in these signs of bread and wine, you reassure us that your Son will be coming soon among us. May we be the humble servants of the light and joy and the great hope for which humanity is waiting. May our lives proclaim that message that you are near to us in Jesus Christ, our brother. The Lord be with you.
And also
lift up your hearts.
Lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
This is right.
We thank you, Father in heaven, and praise you through our Lord Jesus Christ. You promised him as Savior to a lost humanity. His truth shines for those who seek. His power strengthens the weak. His mercy brings forgiveness to sinners. For he is the Savior of the world whom you sent because of your faithfulness. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with the cherubim and seraphim and all the choirs of angels as we sing your glory. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power, God of might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna in the highest. All merciful Father and Mother, accept our praise, our thanks, and our gifts. We humbly implore you and pray you to bless us and all who are united in the meal of love to proclaim your death of the Lord until he comes again. The whole church on earth joins us in this celebration. Listen to our prayer and grant us unity and peace and your spirit. Look upon all who seek you and believe in you. Strengthen our bishops Tom, Terry, Jim, and Joe, the Bishop of Rome, Francis, the fellowship of all bishops and all women and men in the apostolic ministry. Bless all peoples and all who are responsible for peace and justice. Remember also all for whom we ask you. At this time, people that you may wish to pray.
That's it.
like us, they are all yours. You look into our hearts, you know our faith, but our fears as well. Make us open to you and lead us to salvation, uniting us in one holy fellowship. We praise you with Mary, the mother of our Redeemer, and with all the apostles, martyrs, confessors of faith. May their word, example, and prayer bear fruit among all of us and for all of us. Send us your Holy Spirit, the giver of all life and sanctification, that these gifts of the earth, the commandment of your Son, be fulfilled. Give us the bread that we break in the sharing of the body of our Lord, and the cup which we bless as a sharing in the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. On the day before he suffered, he took bread, he gave you thanks, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat it. This is my body, which will be given up for you." After supper, he likewise took the cup, and when he had again given you thanks, gave the cup to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. This is the cup of my blood, the blood of the new and everlasting covenant. It will be shed for you and for all, so that sins may be forgiven. Do this in memory of me."
Let us proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
We and all your church, therefore, remember the saving death of your Son, our Lord and brother Jesus Christ, his resurrection from the dead, and his exaltation to your right hand. He gives himself for us as a pure and holy sacrifice, giving him to us as the holy bread of eternal life and the cup of everlasting salvation. Father and Mother, you have called us to communion around this table. Fill us through your body and blood of your Son with all the blessing and all the grace of heaven. We ask you to remember all who have gone before us in the sign of faith and now rest in peace. May we and all for whom your Son has died share in his resurrection. Accept us sinners too, who trust in the fullness of your love, into the fellowship of your salvation, with all whose life has come to completion with you, not because you would merit it, but because you are granting your mercy through our Lord and brother Jesus. As we sing together,
through him, with him, in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, Almighty Father, forever and ever. Amen, 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 amen.
Let us pray to our parent in heaven that we may seek the will and sow the seeds of the kingdom. Our Father and Mother in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses.
sign of the presence of your Son on earth. Turn our hearts to you and free us from sin as we wait in joyful hope for the full coming among us of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Jesus, Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us. Jesus, Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us. Jesus, Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Grant us your world. Happy are we to be invited to prepare the way for his coming, that people all over the world may see his salvation. Jesus, you made me worthy to receive you. You have said the word, and I am healed. While I'm washing the dishes, I might as well tell you what's going on. The Christmas families, I'll be emailing you a lot, so make sure you watch your emails. Both families have already had the trees ordered. The first family already got it. I'm trying to be a little more modern and have things delivered in that sense. I have made reservations for the first family at 4 o'clock at Puka de Peppo at the Florida Mall for Christmas Day. And so I've been in communication with them. And the second family, I'm going to ask them, even though they can cook a meal, I'm going to ask them if they want to go out. And we'll see. And then I'm going to try to get Puka to maybe do what they did for me many years ago. And to pay for it.
Well, to get
if,
it.
If not, then the parish will pay for
it. Puka didn't pay for the restaurant.
Oh, we just donated money.
That's
so
fine.
You can use it however.
Yeah, that's fine.
Okay.
And if any of you are getting gifts, I'm shooting on December 22nd for the day we go and deliver them. And that's what he's going to order. He doesn't even realize it.
So, just
come
back.
Yeah, next week I will be away, so you're not going to miss till the week after.
The
week after.
Yeah.
The week after. And do we wrap everything?
Yes.
Including
the diapers, just put a name on it. You know, you get this for because you got the kids' names. And, you know, we'll do it like that for that. If you go in that route, I think we bid a little more than we could chew this year. Especially, I couldn't turn around and say no to the public schools. But this public school family, if you've seen it already, is not as many kids, and they're older, and you know, so.
I just got a second family. Mm-hmm.
How many kids do you have? I know it's the same.
They have four kids, 14 years old, and you know, it's a little bit more than the other.
There's 13 people.
We have 11 kids, and a mama and dad on the second family, and only a mama on the first family. Well, because when you get a gift, you email me and say, all right, I got Malik, you know, a car,
okay.
You know, a motorized car. Then I send out an email to everybody saying, all right, like I did with you, you know, because Sandy said she was going to be get the diapers. So I sent out an email to everybody saying, all right, Sandy's getting the diapers, so you know that's her. That's what Graham and I are doing. I'm ordering the gifts and they're coming to our house. Don't worry about it. The more the merrier. As long as they all have at least one gift open, including the parents.
I spent my budget on them, so I can't even help exactly
that. And if you have any relatives and all that want to help out, tell them. You know, and the more the merrier. You know, share the list with you know, your friends, relatives, enemies, anybody. You know, the more the merrier. Because I'm a little nervous on how much we're going to get, because I think it's going to be the core of us here. I don't think those who don't come are going to be sharing.
Much, yeah, no.
You know,
yeah.
Well, as of
right
now, not.
We know Jane.
She
already
Jane already gave us a contribution. Leslie gave us a contribution. Father Anthony gave us a contribution.
I told you I would, but I forgot my checkbook that I put out on Friday. I mean, Sunday.
Yeah, don't worry. We're all good. And if you know, if you want to get gifts via that lovely thing called the internet, Amazon or whatever, have it delivered. delivered to your house.
That's what I did.
We're modernizing this a little bit here. So if heaven doesn't have the IT, we're going to have it. For that. Okay. And I told you already about Marion. So, and folks watching, please pray for Marion and for Carol and for Joel. They need our prayers because of the illnesses that they've got.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah,
she's home. You're just waiting to see the results of the test. Okay, let's finish up. Let us pray. God of hope, in this Eucharist we have celebrated again the coming of your Son in our midst through the Eucharist. Let this belief encounter with him refresh and restore us to become humble road signs to a justice, to a peace, to a dignity, and a joy that far surpasses our powers, but which can be shared by all if we let your Son go with us on this journey with you. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
To be a highway to God, level, smooth, and straight, unlike what we see on I-4, we need to become more Christ-like ourselves. We can show others the road to Christ and prepare the way for his full coming only if we ourselves take his gospel seriously. If the Lord becomes visible in us, his goodness, his compassion, his love, his concern for justice and truth, and we will definitely spread the gospel without using words. And may Almighty God give you this strength and bless you all, the Creator, the Redeemer, and the Sanctifier.
Amen.
Amen. Let us go with one another the way of the Lord and teach others to do the same.
Amen.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
And our closing hymn is going to be in the music side, number 729.
The King of Glory.